Hey, Vsauce, Squash here. Silence is not often truly silent. Okay, I'm sorry, I cannot help myself with that one. Our ears can detect high-pitched, faint sounds that in the world of audio engineering, electronic engineering, and physics belong to the noise spectrum. Curiously, each type of noise on the noise spectrum is labeled by color, but why is that so? When you think of noise, you probably think about a loud city with car horns or people's footsteps running over concrete or even a noisy neighbor playing their music too loudly. But this isn't the type of noise that we're talking about. The sound heard on the noise spectrum is often filtered out by our brains or barely audible in daily life. It could be a faint gust of wind that barely registers, or it could be the slight coil whine from our computers. And most people vaguely know what white noise is, similar to TV static or compressed air, but there's actually way more different types of noise than just white noise. For example, pink noise is sometimes described as a rushing waterfall, whereas blue noise is like water trying to rush through a kinked hose. There are a huge amount of different settings and contexts in which you can hear each different type of noise, both in nature and man-made. Some of them are unintentional, and some are actually used in audio engineering or sound design and can actually sound pretty pleasing to the ears if engineered correctly. To answer our original question about why noise has a color though, first we need to talk about light. So you've probably heard about the visible light spectrum before in school, or maybe even another YouTube video. Basically, it's a spectrum of different wavelengths of light separated by the color that those wavelengths create that we can see as humans. It was theorized about in the 13th century, but little progress was made studying it until Isaac Newton was credited with the first person to use the word spectrum when describing his experiments with optics. When he shined a light through a glass prism at a certain angle, he found that some light passes through and some comes out the other side as different bands of colors. This discovery would eventually lead us to where we are now, with computers being able to display a decent portion of the color spectrum that we can see with the naked eye. But what does this have to do with different noise types? Well, just like light being divided into bands based on what color they create, noise can be divided in a similar way. And this is why color is assigned to different noise types. If you were to display the sound wave pattern of, say, something like blue noise as light with a computer, the resulting light would actually be blue as well. This analogy is great for having a quick and easy name for each type of noise, but it doesn't really tell us the full story. If I asked the average person what pink sounds like, they'd probably have no idea, because what does pink really sound like? And for that matter, what does any color sound like? And to answer that, we'll first need to turn on our old TVs to hear the kind of noise that people are most familiar with, white noise. If you weren't alive in the 90s or even kind of the 2000s, you might not be familiar with this, but old TVs, when they had no signal, they display a random pixel pattern of black and white and play this ear-grating static sound. This is a form of white noise that I guess is probably the most common that people know of. Going back to our loose color spectrum analogy for light and noise, white light is a combination of all the different wavelengths of light combined that we can see on the visible spectrum. White noise, on the other hand, has a sort of similar property. It's made up of an equal amount of signal power across the entire frequency spectrum. This property is why white noise looks mostly flat on a graph, and why it produces that random pixel pattern on old TVs. Speaking of randomness, the website random.org uses atmospheric noise to generate true random numbers, and this type of true randomness can be sort of thought as like white noise from space. On the creative end though, there are a ton of different applications that people use white noise for. You may have heard the term white noise in music production when people are talking about those falling or rising whoosh sounds that sort of sound like this. And those are used to build up or release tension in an arrangement of music. There are even audio plugins that apply white noise effects or vinyl crackles to give a sound sort of like a lo-fi or unpolished feel. Outside of music though, people use white noise all the time, like in their YouTube videos, to cut between clips or denote like a blooper or outtake. But these are all synthetic uses of white noise, because it's fairly rare to find naturally. However, there is another type of noise that may as well have been nature's gift to the world, and that is pink noise. Pink Snake noise can be found all around us, which might explain why it sounds so soothing to our ears. This is why people love falling asleep to the sounds of ocean waves, rain, or waterfalls. Pink noise, unlike white noise, follows a linear logarithmic scale downward from the low end of the frequency spectrum to the high end, making it compose much more of low-end noise. Another way to think of this is that every single octave of pink noise has the same amount of energy. This type of logarithmic scale can be found in an insane amount of places in nature, like heartbeats, the ocean tide, or even neurons firing in our brains. But we also see the blueprint of pink noise in our computers as well. If you look at any graphic equalizer, their interface mimics that of how pink noise would be distributed on a scale. If you've ever wondered why there seems to be so much more precision as you go lower on the frequency spectrum when using an equalizer, well, now you know. This is because human hearing functions in much the same way. We're much more sensitive to low-end sound and can detect small, minute changes in low and middle-end frequencies. The crazy part here is it seems like humans tend to naturally form pink noise signals in the weirdest of places without thinking about it. Researchers have plotted musical melodies from all different time periods and locations, and they all tend to follow pink noise distribution. Even weirder than that, though, movies from different directors, different time periods, and different countries all have a shot length that follow the same type of pink noise distribution. If we look at how pink noise is displayed visually, though, we can see how much more calm it is in comparison to the TV static from white noise. It's sort of like a 2D lava lamp or one of those abstract Windows Media Player visualizations that just kind of hypnotizes you. But there's another type of noise that's even deeper than pink noise, and to hear it, all we need to do is start up a fire. Fire crackling or distant thunderous booms from the sky, these are examples of Brownian noise. Named after Robert Brown, who documented the random pattern that pollen made in water when looked at under a microscope. This is the first type of noise that kind of breaks down our color analogy, however, it is also called red noise. This is because it's strongest with long wavelengths, similar to how red is at the end of the visible light spectrum. To me, red noise is the most interesting, not because of its sound profile or the math behind it, but because there's sort of this weird cult that formed around brown or red noise. You can find hundreds of 10-hour loops on YouTube with tens of millions of views, and even on Spotify, there are literally playlists of brown noise with billions of streams. Communities of people literally swear by its ability to turn off your brain or calm yourself down and even alleviate symptoms of ADHD. Whether or not this is actually the case has yet to be studied, but I mean, if you think it helps you, then you do you. I don't really think there's that much harm in it. Outside of the brown and red noise cult, though, its applications are insanely cool. You can use it to simulate being underwater or even as a backing portion of a video to set a certain tone. I think the best example of this is from a video by Yes Theory, where one of their members does a halo jump out of a plane. In this video, the editor perfectly nails this type of sound effect. Amar jumps out of the plane with the wind rushing by, and then suddenly everything slows down, and the wind sounds are gone, and all that's left is this subtle underwater drone playing. I mean, come on. After seeing that, you cannot tell me that the noise spectrum isn't f***ing awesome. Without a doubt, it's one of the best uses of the noise spectrum by a YouTube video editor, and this type of stuff can be found around us without us even realizing it. White, pink, and brown noise are just the tip of the iceberg, though. I could make an hour-long video about the full noise spectrum, but that's a video for another day. So yeah, I think that the color of noise is something that isn't talked about too much, but I think it should be. We're almost constantly surrounded by it, but it slips under the radar in our daily lives. So the next time you hear something on the noise spectrum, you'll know that it's not always just black and white. And as always, thanks for watching.